assistant professor and head of the Department of Zoology and the IQAC coordinator of St. Francis de Sales College, Nagpur, extend to all of you a warm welcome on behalf of my college and its IQAC. St. Francis de Sales College, a Catholic minority Archbishop Eugene de Souza. Now in its 65th year, it is presided over by the Archbishop of Nagpur, His Grace Most Reverend Elias Gonzalez. Inspired by the teachings and love of Jesus Christ and based on the motto of truth and love, the institution has been ensuring a holistic development of its students, fostering self-reliance and confidence enhanced by the qualities of keenness, cooperation, and fair-mindedness so as to make them the incorruptible citizens of tomorrow. The college, although a minority institution, welcomes all, staff and students alike, with open arms, irrespective of their religion, caste, or creed. The college has undergone 3 cycles of accreditation, and in the 3rd cycle has been accredited with an A grade and a CGPA of 3.23 by the National Assessment and Accreditation Council, well known as NAC, Bangalore. The recent advances in information and communication technology have been able to tremendously increase our access to information, helping us to bring quality into our work of imparting knowledge. This has caused a narrowing down of the focus from quality to quality assurance, and then the quality enhancement, till better has become a keyword for us all. In its quest for the better, the NAC too has introduced several changes in the new methodology for carrying out the assessment and accreditation process of the higher education institutions. Great emphasis is now laid on data-based quantitative evaluation, extensive use of ICT, pre-qualifier marks, third-party validation of data, and a system-generated score. In view of these drastic changes, the HEIs need to understand and implement practices and processes for benchmarking quality within their institutions. Close on to the doorstep of the next cycle of accreditation, need has been felt time and again by our college to get tips from all possible quarters so that we can maintain and aim to achieve the grade obtained in the previous cycle. The idea of this online 4-day national workshop titled Intricacies of NAC Assessment for Better Scoring was born out of this need. It is aimed at unraveling the problems faced and suggesting solutions to these problems and challenges. It aims to provide detailed analysis made by eminent speakers, criterion-wise, to solve the intricacies in the assessment process. Today, following the keynote address, there will be analysis of criterion 1. Day 2, 3, and 4 of the workshop will see for the workshop will be held on the 5th day, that is on the July 31st. With the help of this workshop, I am sure we shall get many useful tips on how to further improve upon our quality culture in different ways and to digitally empower the system using new technologies to the best advantage of all our stakeholders. So with this, I now call upon our Archbishop, Most Reverend Elias Gonzalez, to inaugurate the program. To inaugurate and bless this endeavor of our college, I take pride in welcoming His Grace was installed as the Metropolitan Archbishop of Nagpur in January 2019. He has been in charge of Catholic education in Western Region Catholic Bishop Council. His Grace is the promoter of the online program titled Education on Family Values for Western Region Catholic Schools. His Grace takes keen interest in the rapidly changing field of education, and he is the guiding force for our college. His active and benevolent support serves to strengthen our resolve and forge a way ahead towards everything that is better. I request you, Your Grace, to inaugurate this online workshop and say a few words on the occasion. Your Grace, please.
Good morning to one and all, and most welcome to join this workshop this morning. And as we begin this workshop, I would like to welcome all of you in a special way to join and participate actively in this whole process of workshop on intricacies of NAC assessment for better scoring. I'm sure all of us try to do our best and see how we can space in the whole process of acquiring NAC accreditation. It's my great privilege today to be with you all at this inaugural moment of this workshop. As it is placed before you, the vision of NAC to make a quality the defining element of higher education in India through a combination of self and external quality evaluation, promotion and sustenance initiative is the vision of NAC. NAC has its own mission. And as we look at the mission of NAC, it is trying to take the whole education at different level and make education all inclusive so that every area of our community, every person in the community gets the benefit of the NAC, the whole higher education process. The core values that NAC is holding, the five core values as it is presented here, the contributing to national development, fostering global competencies among students, inculcating a value system among the students, promoting the use of technology and quest for excellence. My dear friends, today's challenge before all of us is for the holistic education. And in this regard, Pope Francis, he is a strong educationist and trying to promote family values as an educational setting. In his one of his documents, Amoris Laetitia, The Joy of Love, he says the family is the first school of human values. When we learn the wise use of freedom, certain inclinations develop in childhood and become so deeply rooted that they remain throughout life, either as attraction to a particular value or a natural repugnance to certain ways of acting. Many people think and act in a certain way because they deem it to be right on the basis of what they learned, as if by osmosis from their earliest years. That is how I was taught. That's what I learned to do. Dear friends, all of us have this background, that which we come from. We come from different cultures, different language groups, different communities, different regions. And then we have a greater role to play in our educational institutions. In order to achieve something which is very concrete, this goal in our educational system, we have to use the See Judge Act format as part of our curriculum. Our system should think more globally and act locally. Father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhiji, said, we will be able to say this, that this action of ours is going to help the poorest of the poor, whom we know solidarity is a commitment to the common good in contrast to any personal good. He was upholding this value. Pope Francis, in his documents, constantly is focusing that Catholic education is has the greatest challenges for the church today, which is committed to carrying out the gospel values in a historic and actual context that is in constant transformation. My dear friends, when we are in a constant transformation, we need to see how we can read the signs of the time and become world. And therefore, he has proposed three aspects for consideration: the value of dialogue in education, the second, the quality and the qualified preparation of the formators, and the third, the responsibility of educational institution to express the living presence of the living of the values in the field of education, science and culture. These three aspects I would like to focus on and you all to reflect during this process of whole workshop, that our Catholic schools and universities are attended by many students who are not Christians or do not believe in God. Catholic educational institutions offer to all an approach to education that has its aim the full development of the person, which responds to the right of every person to access knowledge. However, they are also called upon to offer with full respect for the freedom of each person and to press exchange of views and ideas and building up the persons in today's multicultural society. And therefore, my friends, dialogue is one of the keys that which we need to uphold in our educational system. The second aspect is preparing formators. Education in our times is guiding by a changing generation, and every educator and the church as a whole, who is an educating mother, are required to change and communicate with the young. The church must be well equipped with persons trained to train others. Our young minds need to form in a proper value system, thereby they look at life with more focused, more meaningful, and with purpose. The third is responsibility of educational institutions. all of us strive to get upgradation in NAC. But at the same time, we have the responsibility. Our responsibility is to express the living presence of the gospel values. Each of us come from different religion, different tradition, different backgrounds, and we hold our values dear to us. And these values need to be upheld in our education, science, and culture. Pope Francis stresses on the need for Catholic academic institutions to be part and parcel of the world of education, being one and united with people. This invites us to have constant encounter between faiths, reason, and the senses, with a view to develop new approaches and arguments, bringing greater openness to the gospel values. And therefore, my dear friends, as I conclude, I would like to once again remind all of you to focus your thinking, that is, which is out of box thinking, not just with limited view or limited attitude, reaching out to the last list and the lost in the community. And we all are under the obligation to educate our children in virtues so that they live lives inspired by the values. At the same time, it will offer its assistance to all peoples for the promotion of a well-balanced perfection of the human personality, for the good of society, and for the development of a world more worthy of human living. In short, I mean to say, give human face to the education, not imbalanced with competence or competition, striving for grades higher and higher, but rather make giving human face to our education system. And with this, once again, I would like to wish all of you all the best for this workshop. And hereby, I announce that this workshop is inaugurated, and I wish every participant with every best wish for the days to come. Thank you, and God bless you. Thanks.
Thank you. Reminded us once again about the importance of values in education. Thank you for bringing to us about the importance of values and a human face in education, more especially so somewhere along the way, sometimes humanity gets lost. So here we striving for better grades, because that has to be done if one is to survive in this today's educational competition. But then at the same time, we will not forget for a moment that humanity also has its own importance, and it can be nurtured only if we follow the values as have been laid down in the gospel. So thank you, Bishop, for sparing time to coming online and sparing time for us to inaugurate this workshop. Thank you once again.
Thank you. Thank you, and all the best. God bless you. Thank you.
Friends, it is indeed a great pleasure to workshop Dr. S. Alfred Cecil Raj, who is Associate Professor of Physics, St. Joseph's College, Tiruchirappalli, Tamil Nadu. First and foremost, Dr. Alfred, like many of us, is a teacher teaching physics since 1986. He specializes in crystal growth and phonon physics and is a member of the Indian Association of Crystal Growth. He has 53 research articles to his credit and has guided 6 PhD theses with 4 more underway. He has supervised the work of many MPhil scholars, handled 3 research projects worth more than rupees 21 lakhs. He has organized several conferences, workshops and seminars and has prepared valuable resources in physics in the form of books, manuals, course materials for students. As a teacher, he has earned laurels in the form of as many as 15 awards from 2008 to the present day. Such a distinguished teacher, ladies and gentlemen, cannot remain confined to teaching his own subject. He hones and polishes himself with other competencies into achieving a state of an increasingly dazzling brilliance. Dr. Alfred Cecil Raj has established his additional mastery in the fields of ICT-enabled teaching, manpower planning, and animation. These have added to his capabilities the strengths of goal setting, innovation, and team building. Based on these strengths, he has been ably handling additional institutional responsibilities in administration, curriculum designing, mentoring and counseling, organizing and manpower management. He has handled diverse responsibilities. He was the Dean, Faculty of Sciences and the NIRF Nodal Officer for his college. He was the Dean cum Member Secretary IQAC, commendable grade of A++ in 2019. He is also at present the Controller of Examinations in his college, as well as the Accreditation Ambassador Paramarsh Scheme of St. Joseph's College for 2019-20. Friends, due to his expertise in NAC and true to the noble ideal pro bono et vero of the St. Joseph's College, he has been helping for the good and the true many colleges in need that have appealed to him. He has conducted many academic audits and pre-NAC cum academic audits, helped more than 20 colleges for data validation and support and for their assessment by NAC in the past year. Welcome again, respected sir, assessment for better scoring. I now request you, sir, to proceed with your keynote address. Dr. Alfred, please.
Thank you, professors. A very good morning to one and all gathered in this webinar titled Intricacies of NAC Assessment for Better Scoring, organized by St. Francis de Sales College, Nagpur. Indeed, it is a great honor and privilege given to all the resource persons from Tamil Nadu and to me to be here to deliver the keynote address on the 4-day national webinar. My greetings and thanks to the management of the prestigious institution, especially the principal, Dr. K.T. Thomas, and the participant delegates. Before the real business, let me say something about my institution. I have the privilege of working for my institution, my alma mater, that in turn to the nation through education. My institution is a premier institution, 175-year-old heritage college, has a very big list of its contribution by its existence as an institute of excellence, where the UGC has enlisted among a few colleges and wants us to go for the deemed university status. At this juncture, I thank the management fathers, especially my principal fathers, for permitting me to support many higher education institutions towards their autonomy, curricular design process, accreditation, and other allied areas to showcase their unique entity in the field of education. My presence in this webinar is also one such part of India. Contributed to the nation building by producing good number of luminaries in different walks of life. As the policy for admission and lift the life of the marginalized and downtrodden without sacrifice. Knowledge is the true basis of higher education. Its production via must remain the prime objective of any institution of higher education, including universities in any country. These institutions are focusing resources on quality education, encouraging students and taking account of the students' profiles and specific needs, strengthening teacher empowerment and exposure to the best working practices, and creating incentives to attract the most experienced teachers. Countries are putting knowledge at the service of their societies to create a better world. This can be achieved through the training of the first-class minds, through major advances in science and technology, and by encouraging an interest in the learning. Now, to realize its full potential, higher education is to maintain proactive stance, strengthen its position as a bedrock upon which countries are, and build a new road to growth. It cannot be passive. The ambitious goal for sustainability, which is robust, well-planned, and sustainable growth for quality of higher education through three E's simultaneously, namely excellence, expansion, and equity, without compromising the quality and enhancing the current gross enrollment ratio from 25 to 30 by 2022. The decade 2019 to 2029 would be crucial for not only the world economy, but also for the Indian economy. This fourth industrial revolution is the decade of disruption, because many disruptive technologies which emerged during the last decade will attain their momentum across all industries, across all nations, and in every place of human life, such as workplaces, homes, transports, hospitals, schools, colleges, and hospitality. Disruptive technologies like AI, robotics, IoT, deep learning, machine learning, cloud computing, virtual reality, 3D printing, nanotechnologies have created VUCA world, that is volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. If we do not prepare ourselves fast for this new phase in human civilization, we will face disaster. India has to take a call on it, and an urgent one at that, if it has to become new India at 75. Thus, raising the quality of Indian higher education expeditiously and exponentially by infusing massive funds and by the application of technology at all levels in higher education. They are teaching students. Slow improvements or incremental methods will not yield results. We have to work with a great sense of urgency, or otherwise we will miss the bus of the fourth industrial revolution. Quality assurance in higher education institutions is mandatory, as it ensures the accountability and improves quality benchmark goals, ensuring the stakeholders the best of education. Higher educational institutions throughout India are necessitated to ensure quality assurance through national level accreditation process. Although many institutions have in place a mechanism ensuring quality assurance, This means to the lack of institutionalization of quality assurance systems in higher education. The different terms on quality, such as quality awareness, quality attainment, quality sustenance, quality enhancement, etc., are all not fixed and standard, but highly local and achievable through quality culture. But due to globalization, we wish to make the quality to be more generic and common. That is why all our higher education institutions are struggling to be competitive within rank. But there is a term called quality control, which is applicable in industries. But quality benchmarking is always possible. Hence, in NAC, they are termed as qualitative metrics, quantitative metrics, CGPA, and grades. It is not the same for all the institutions and all the cycles. As of now, the higher education demands globalization of education through online learning, mobile learning, and remote learning. They need to invest large on the infrastructure. There will be more on competitions, increasing, ever-increasing competitions in the institution in terms of staffs and students, research funding and partnerships. And all the institutions are investing heavily on the ICT to support and maintain the competitive positions. In this pandemic situation, whether this accessibility, equity, expansion and excellence is possible, because this pandemic will prevail at least in 2 or 3 more years. Institutional quality assurance, where the requirement talks about either for the institute, entire institute, quality assurance in terms of entire institution. Whereas the National Board of Accreditation talks about the programs, namely the MCA, MBA programs. Whether they are all standards, is there any standard to achieve the assurance? Whatever it may be the standard, there are certain ideas like policies and procedures, formal mechanism, and learning resource and student support with MIS and public informations are very much. We all of us know that success is possible only through commitment, whether it is a NAC or anything. To achieve anything, we need to have a team building and team work, as a networking is of paramount importance to any activity, and especially in the modeling your institutional quality depends upon your institutional staff profile. How the institute is also important to achieve quality. Every institution is striving to become better and better, but that striving better through continuous improvement is very much needed. And it is a very simple process by Deming's PDCA cycle: plan, do, check, and act appropriately with a proper strategic plans. By using that PDCA cycle, we can march ahead to reach the global standards. So change is always inevitable. Adapt to the changes to meet the global challenges. The quality dimensions in the higher educations are sixfold, namely tangible, competence, attitude, content, delivery, and reliability. If things are to be tangible, measurable, all activities should be measured. When we measure any activity carried out in the institution, whether the data is comparatively good or bad has to be understood with reference to the benchmark. So a benchmark has to be fixed by the institution to reach the ivory tower. Namely, the data is very much essential to the present manual. Data is possible only when the attitude of faculty is cohesively supporting the higher education institution. If some lacuna is present among the faculty, the attitude brings down the score of the institution. Therefore, the attitude mindset of the faculty is very important to achieve the ivory tower. What is given out alone can be retrieved. Therefore, what we give it to the students alone can be retrieved. Therefore, faculty members should provide a good content and good delivery through their teaching learning evaluation process. This is very important to score in the NAAC manual, because it carries 300 marks or 350 marks out of 1,000. And when these data are pooled appropriately, the reliability of your data is based on your documentation procedures, and it should be understood data and evidences such that the reliable data will bring you to the highest level. So the quality dimensions can be broken into three parameters as a core value: defining quality, measuring quality, and improving quality. If I keep them together, I will be able to achieve the quality assurance of my institution. But all the time, the sides of the triangle will be always incomplete. Our institution will be able to reach the pinnacle in scoring. It's already pointed out by our bishop as well as the IQAC coordinator professor, the core values expected by the higher education institution by the NAAC should be a dynamic. The core values must be dynamic in any system, so that the cyclic behavior of the core values with good CGPA in the NAAC assessment and accreditation process. So the person who is in charge of this quality assurance should have a broader thinking, deeper thinking, and plan properly, continuously to bring the institution to the higher level. Therefore, it is a continuous improvement is essential from day one till the cycle is completed. So the output of a quality assurance depends upon the compliance agencies like quality assurance society in terms of NAAC or NIRF or any other agencies like UGC, etc., that for which there must be a regular discussions and improvement on the process to achieve the good assurance, quality assurance. Therefore, we require to have an understanding on internal quality assurance system, not as a cell. There must be an internal quality assurance system in the institution should talk about the policies and procedures to achieve the quality assurance, approval, monitoring, periodic review of the programs and awards in the curricular aspect, assessment of students in terms of evaluations, quality assurance of teaching staff, teacher profile, their contributions towards research and extension activities. To promote these features, what are the learning resources and student support systems are prevailing in the institutions, how best we can promote these facilities across the period of a cycle, and how this can be disseminated to the stakeholders, that should be planned in the IQEAS of the institution. So there will be an IQAC, a cell comprising of certain members, but unless there is a system present in the institution which cannot forward this idea with the compliance agencies, which we call it as an extensive talks about different parameters and criterions. Therefore, the institution should work not only for those criterions and parameters, but it should think about holistically for the promotion of students and teachers and well-wishers of the institutes. So development and external quality assurance process inside the quality assurance system is very much essential based on certain discussions and policies. Therefore, that...
Sorry for the interruption, Dr. Yes. Alfred. The small window on your screen is actually interfering with your presentation. So if you could please minimize that.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome, sir. If you are able to appropriately discuss in the IQAS of your institution by properly reporting it with the follow-up procedures, with the periodic reviews, you can have a rapport with the external agency. A good rapport will fetch you a good CGPA. Therefore, the process is simply understanding the institutional strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and challenges prevailing to achieve this CGPA. So as in a computer system, the quality assessment model proposed by NAC itself is input, process, and outputs. As many as 34 inputs are taken to achieve 67 outputs expected for a NAC. Therefore, the inputs are very well stated, like students, curriculum design, and institutional support and feedback processes to carry out the input process wisely and create a proper processing tool to deliver the output, which is nothing but the output of a student's output of research and output of the fund generated. Therefore, the quality model talks about institutionalization. So the institutionalization, which contains the three dimensions, dimension of quality, quality measurement, and quality improvement process. So this is kept as a center. There will be 8 essential elements or building blocks necessary to support and ensure sustainable implement of these core quality assurance activities over the time. These 8 essential elements can be grouped under 3 categories. They are the internal enabling environment. The enabling environment contains the essential elements which are 4 in number that make up the environment conducive for the organization, namely the policy, leadership, core values, and resources. Sustainable quality assurance requires policy environment that explicitly recognizes the importance of quality for reaching organizational or systems goal, and that provides support, guidance, and reinforcement of quality assurance implementation. In addition to leadership, it's critical to help the organization see where it needs to go to provide strategies for the transition from the way we work now to the way we want to work in future, to promote a learning environment and to a model the desired core values that should characterize the organizational culture. Leadership may play a special role in organizational readiness to sustain quality. Core organizational values emphasize respect, quality, and continued improvement. The creation and acculturation of these core values throughout the organization are critical to ensure that all staff see their contributions to quality as important and desire to be part of these efforts. Finally, quality assurance cannot be sustained if there are not adequate resources allocated for quality assurance, particularly staff time to be involved in quality assurance efforts, but also resources for capacity building, communication, and other key aspect functions. each of these four essential elements is important in its own right, but full effects depends upon the synergy created among the four. The second institutional category is structure. Organizing for quality refers for delineation of responsibilities and accountability for oversight, coordination, and implementation of quality assurance in the organization of system. Thus, in addition to the essential elements that comprise the enabling environment, sustainable quality assurance also requires an essential element, some kind of structure. In this context, structure should not be equated with an organizational chart or reporting hierarchy. Quality assurance activities have now been incorporated into the responsibilities of every individual. So this is what expected in the current manual. Structure of implementing quality assurance is vested with the individual, not with the IQAC or with the principal or the chairperson of the institution. The third essential element, or primarily a support function, which are essential to improve the quality of care, the capacity building, communication and information, and rewarding quality. Capacity building refers to the ongoing process of ensuring that staff have the necessary technical, managerial, and leadership knowledge and skills to carry out their quality assurance responsibilities, and that they know when and how to use these skills best. Capacity building encompasses formal quality assurance training, coaching and mentoring, self and peer appraisals, performance improvements, and supervisory activities. Local quality assurance coaches and trainees to keep up with the demands and expansion of quality assurance efforts. So this is actually where the IQAC said. Communication and information is the next important area for sharing, learning, and advocating quality assurance, which involves a two-way interaction between organizational staff, target communities, and other stakeholders. Communication and information include recording improvements and changes and using data to demonstrate results and stories about how these results were achieved, sharing what has been achieved and how it was done with the organization staff, the community itself, and others who might learn from it and become motivated to improve their own services. And thirdly, using the results for advocating policy changes and resource allocation. Communication reinforces the notion that the quality assurance is everyone's business. I repeat, quality assurance is everyone's business, that success should be shared and the lessons that can be learned, and even things do not go as we planned. Third item is rewarding quality, and the efforts made to improve quality foster both commitment to quality and motivation to strive for excellence, providing individual, group, or even organizational recognition or rewards reinforce the interest in quality assurance endeavors and facilitate alignments or staff with organizational values. This implies examining and removing disincentives or barriers to quality that currently exist, as well as developing mechanisms to recognize and reward appropriate behaviors, efforts, and achievements. So I wish every institution should develop an institutional quality based on the model with the help of the faculty members available in the institution. There are four-way processes to achieve this based on the benchmarks fixed by the agencies, quality assurance agencies, through strategic quality assurance, systematic quality assurance, and functional quality assurance in order to fulfill the stakeholders' need. If all these things are aligned in a collinear plane, the results are definite, through which educational results are possible, research results are possible, extension results are possible, as well as funding results are also possible. In a nutshell, quality assurance is a crucial in higher education based on the premise that the processes and procedures of a quality have to be clearly chalked out. The effectiveness of different processes should be vetted and measured. Outcomes should be assessed and shared with the different stakeholders. So quality assurance, to be successful, it has to be developed as a culture which is self-sustained, self-renewing, and self-rewarding. Therefore, in other words, quality is people's commitment to quality has to be the highest standard. Coming to the revised assessment framework, which is mentioned also by the professor in charge of IQAC, it has got a shift in paradigm shift has been introduced in 2017, and it has been modified and in February 2019, I think it has stopped in the process of improvement. Now, the qualitative peer judgments is based on the data, the quantitative evaluation, and there is a pre-qualifier round. And almost all institutions, the online evaluation is 70% and peer judgment is 30%. It is evaluated by the third party, and there are optional matrices also present. We can go for 970 marks instead of 1,000. So the quality indicator framework, which is given as a criterion by the NAG, which has been for the last 25 years only with a 7 criterion, but they have reduced in number of questions from 300 to some 90 now. But in the present manual, is common for all the colleges and universities only in the 6th and 7th criterion. Referring to criterion 1, it is a curricular aspect which talks about practices of an institution in initiating a wide range of program options at UG, PG, MPhil levels and courses that are in tune with the emerging trends either at the local, regional, national, or at the global levels. It also expects academic flexibility, career options, skill development in order to promote and support students' interest. This criterion has got 4 key indicators. Criterion 2 is teaching learning evaluation. How best the institution supports with the diverse backgrounds of students through different instructional techniques, different modes of learning, including ICT as one of the teaching pedagogue. It also expects how best the planning is done through academic calendar, prepared including the accountability of teachers, delivery mode. It also expects a continuous learning and evaluation from student side and faculty side respectively. This criterion has got 7 key indicators as shown here. Criterion 3, research, innovation, extension, expects institutionalization through policies and practices and its deliverables with reference to research, innovations and extension. It expects teaching is not the only job of a teacher, but it expects them to do research by innovating something for the upliftment of the neighborhood. Thus, the core value of any institution is to support the neighborhood through extension activities and cultivating the value system. It has got 7 indicators as key indicators. Criterion 4 talks about the infrastructure and learning resources. which demands optimal use and adequate infrastructural facilities available in the institution to run the program offered in the higher education institution. It demands how do they budget for the purchase or augmenting the physical learning ICT resources, library resources, in order to support the students and teachers and benefit from it through operational procedures to maintain and replenishing the same. It has got four key indicators. Criterion 5 talks about student supports and progression, which expects the efforts taken by the institution to provide essential assistance in learning, enriching and experiencing the holistic formation. How do they perform in the competitive examinations? How many have joined in the higher studies? How much guidance and helps are provided to them? How many alumni are engaged to create wider publicity of the institution, to create broader network among the institution? It has got four key indicators. Criterion 6 talks about the governance, leadership, management, which is about the effective functioning through institutionalizing through policies and practices, which are with the five key indicators. Last criterion 7, institutional values and best practices, expects how best the institution is changing or opting itself for changes due to the emerging challenges and pressing issues in our country and in the globe. It has got three key indicators. Altogether, there are 34 key indicators present in the NAAC manual. And there may be one or two key indicators or items. We have essential matrices which are referred in criterion 1 to 7. You cannot opt out in submitting the SSR, while there are four criterions in which we can opt out matrices mentioned with the the matrices mentioned with the numbers in yellow color for weightage of 30, and in each criterion you can opt out the matrix only for 10 marks. So while working on in any criterion, keep in mind that the data pooled belonging to different matrices fall in it, and no duplications and redundant data is pooled and used in various matrices. There are certain matrices where the institutions should capitalize those questions and try to get full score. Example, student supports, student satisfaction survey in criterion 2, the internet connectivity present in the institution, computers available in the institutions, or these are all certain questions asked in the manual. The institution should capitalize and to get full score out of this. And there are areas it is very difficult for the institution to get data, because unless and otherwise faculty members work on that, students qualify for that, it is very difficult to get data, namely in criterion 3 and criterion 5. So this table tells you about the various matrices, key indicators, and qualitative and quantitative matrices available for various types of institutions. Especially for affiliated systems, there are only 96 questions, out of which 36 are descriptive, qualitative, which should be described quantitatively in order to qualify for your visit. And this slide talks about a very important distribution of matrices in different criterion, and one should think in terms of numbers, 60. The 60 questions, quantitative matrices, is going to fetch you 70% weightage of the mark. Therefore, every institution should work very carefully on this 60 metrics questions very thoroughly. What I have mentioned in this slide is pertaining to the postgraduate institutions offering postgraduate programs. And one should please remember that the fourth criterion, sixth and seventh criterion, they carry 100 marks, whatever may be the institutions. But questions are slightly, criterion 4, 6 and 7, for all the types of institutions, they carry the same weightage. So this slide talks about the quantitative matrices available in the manual, especially for the affiliated systems, which are characterized in four headings, types like multiple choice questions, which are found 16 in number, formula-based questions, 13 in number. They help you to score good marks based on your data and also based on the extended profile information. Especially the formula-based questions are from the data provided in the extended profile. Well, I wish all the institutions should go through thoroughly, understand the nuances of this table, weightages and mark for each criteria and matrices, as well as how to establish answers for these questions from the institution should be left free. Updated till February 2019. Hence, institutions could not have worked on certain matrices even today. For example, student satisfaction survey, the methodology to score full mark, the different policies outlined in the manual, numbering some areas where no institutions would have completed their task to prepare themselves for the SSR. There are important third party validation of your quantitative matrices in your SSR. There is a 15% deviation while verification is found to be false. Therefore, in the new manual, examination manual, innovation ecosystems, distinctiveness, non-governmental score and mission of the institution, strategy, parameters, aspect for AQAR talks about benchmark yourself and perform back here. It is going to purge high evidences, any data, but pool the data appropriately in a different area, different questions. So it requires some articulations of your manual, read the manual thoroughly. You have done field work, prudent Excel sheets for various quantitative Excel sheets. Straight students have included one column. It is going to create problems when verification. Always instruct the departments not to put any additional columns. Rather, you can add any rows accordingly by introducing a column, but you can introduce a row according to the type and need for calculation purpose. Therefore, when you prepare report link, create a proper link. Putting the data in the college server is also important. Though it is a part of working for the IQAC, it is to be properly planned well ahead of it, and it should be informed to the departments and units while pooling the data. Therefore, the various activities found in the SSR preparations are threefold. Pre-submission demands motivation among faculty, strategic plan of institution, distribution of work, technical support team, and timeline chart for execution. So this is very, very difficult for any institution, and especially the team player of the IQAC. preparing oneself this pre-submission process. During submission process, most of these items are online based, which is portal dependent, starting from registration, IIPA submission, understanding the NAC portal and submission procedures, certain intricacies of the submission procedures, and there are certain improper relationship between the manual and the portal that has to be understood during the submission process. In the post-submission process, creating awareness to all the stakeholders to face the peer team visit. It is again the process to be done by the IQAC, getting ready with the stakeholders, preparing the departments, asking the department to own the data among the non-teaching staff, among the students. And it is also important to have a mock visit prior to the actual visit of the department. Profile of the institution, submission, extended profile of the institution, evaluative report of the department, and the data required. So when they start working on the self-study report, they will come across all these activities one after another, but proper planning will help them to collate appropriately, prudently, wisely, and finish the job in a time-bound manner. In our institutions, we cover the IAQA approval. That is not to blow my own trumpet, our own institution's trumpet, raw time, because 31st day is not permitted by NAC. And other items like which are found in the manual also, uploading only 5 templates as per NAC format, respond to appropriate sites, change translations of regional language documents, documents signed by the competent authority, and read the standard operating procedure in the lines. Though these things are make your... So at the institutional level, team spirit, ego fusions, credibility in terms of all activities and with necessary reports and information. Making the faculty to understand the importance of data and evidences and software at the year common data, manuals and modules, details, snapshots, user logbooks, etc. Annual reports on placement cell. Shall I proceed? Hello?
Yes, sir, you are audible. You are audible, sir.
Okay, sir. Financial audit report, carrying information about energy and green audit, revenue generation through consultancy and corporate training and seed money. Reports of statutory bodies like ICC, anti-ragging cell, IQAC, so parent university permission of various programs and students admission approval, research centers, etc. Minutes with the signature of members for board of studies, academic councils and governing bodies. And you can work based on the timeline chart by stock taking everything on a daily basis to accomplish the self-study report. At the staff level, there should be a support, non-cooperative mentality among with HOD teachings, e-contents prepared, the availability of e-resources in the repository of the college website, teaching records for accountability of for planning, teaching, learning, evaluation methods, and publication details, certificates of certain courses attended by the faculty members, students' progression to higher education and placement details, approved UGC enlisted journals, publications with bibliometric details, mentor-mentee activities, supportive documents, use of only a single mobile number with a single ID. That will help the institution to score full in the student satisfaction survey. Motivate them, the importance of NAC score, and they have to respond for the mail received. Thus, towards excellence, everything will be based on cycle, existence of understanding, survival and existence and excellence will be possible in 20 to 25 years of time. That's what NAC expects. Every institution should strive for its excellence in fourth cycle of accreditation. Of course, every one of you, by now, you know the highest CGPA. And as of as on date in the NAC website, it says that AAA+ is received by 14 higher education institutions. 131 higher education institutions are undergone this exercise, and affiliated colleges of range 26%, roughly 26% of 407 higher education institutions have undergone this exercise. Therefore, the benefit is very essential and natural. We meet the standards in terms of curriculum, administrations, libraries, financial well-being, and student service. And as you know from the NAC website, on my right-hand side on the screen, the NAC process of video tutorials are available, mentioned in them thoroughly. Though it is mentioned, there are certain issues will come across while you feed the data in the portal. The responsibilities include organization of an internal quality network, enhancing communication flow between units among the faculty members in the institutions and make use of them, fostering innovative ideas in order to solve problems, measuring improvements in the quality report provided yearly by each unit about its activities, auditing the activities in cooperation with the management, benchmark challenging exercises for IQAC. So I perceive that the communication flow is going to be the important area for IQAC. There should be an excellent flow of communication within the departments if these observations are followed. Developing a culture of communication and sharing information, well-defined communication responsibilities, clear objectives of communication flow, precise listing of sources and receivers of information. Everyone is aware that quality is not achieved accidentally. It always results from good intention, sincere efforts, and alumni and His Excellency, former President and Student President, People's President, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam.
Excuse me, sir, the audio is not coming in clearly. Please check the audio connections, please, sir.
Audible, sir?
Hello. It's coming better now, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Values and goals of the institution, one can achieve the pinnacle of getting AAA+. So as a physics faculty, I always fascinated by the words of Lord Kelvin in numbers. You know something about it, but when you cannot measure it, when you cannot express it in numbers, your knowledge is of a meager and in your thoughts, advanced to the stage of science, whatever the matter may be. So if you read it once again with the underlined word, measure, express it in numbers, your knowledge, satisfactory, whatever the matter may be. So the current world talks about that really promotes the quality. Value system will also promote the quality of the institution. So that qualify the institution in terms of satellite, in terms of satellite communication. So I wish everyone should walk on this stream of higher education institution, as Jesus walked on water, as Bible says, everyone should try to walk on a challenging exercise found in the higher education institution by coming together, working together, achieving together, which is possible. So to achieve the fruits of NAC, every staff member in the institution should involve in the quality upgradation. Thank you. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, you have taken us each and every aspect, pointing each and every aspect. The exercise has been a wonderful experience, especially where you have pointed out in your slides how the questions are classified.
Yes.
Based on other things, variants and so on. So that was an eye-opener actually, because such classification was not yet made by us.
Okay.
That method of classification is wonderful. Secondly, sir, taking us, reminding us about teamwork, the role of every documentation, the importance of like keeping it, making proper links using ICT. So these things, although they don't appear to be very significant, are the most important ones. Because without that, we cannot proceed, we cannot communicate with the NAC itself. Moreover, sir, you have very importantly pointed out the responsibilities of the responsibilities. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your very wonderful talk.
Thank you, Professor.
We would, of course, be troubling you furthermore to take your guidance on certain issues. I hope you will be available for RCS College on behalf of its IQAC. I express my heartfelt and sincere thanks to you, sir, for giving us this. Sir, thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Professor.
I now, yes, sir.
Do I need to stay here for?
I'll be handing over the proceedings now to Father Praveen D'Souza for the further part of the program. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor.
Father Praveen, please.
One second.
Participants will please hold on for some time till the technical issues are sorted out. I'm handing over the proceedings to an assistant professor in the Department of Philosophy. Please carry on, Father. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Bagadis, sir. And since you have introduced me already, of our next resource person who will be sharing his thoughts on the first criterion of NAC, and if one is not functioning properly, then the whole wheel will not work well as we desire. So giving due importance to each criterion, we have various resource persons who are qualified and then who have come from, as we heard, A++ colleges. He is an assistant professor of computer science and former coordinator, bringing 6 years of research experience. He has also 8 years of industrial experience. He has published more than 7 articles in reputed journals, presented papers in international conferences, and written book chapters for computer literacy course. He offers consultancy for 5 colleges regarding SSR submission and DVV, that is data verification. He has contributed to his own college in the preparatory work for the 3rd and 4th cycles of NAC accreditation. Dr. D, by designing and developing software applications on staff evaluation and SSR data entry portal. On behalf of St. Francis de Sales College, Nagpur, I warmly welcome you, Dr. Jude, to this 5-day workshop. And now I invite you for your presentation, Peps. Over to you, Dr. Jewell. Dr. Jewell, could you please unmute yourself?
Is it audible, Father and professors? Good afternoon. I am very much happy to be present this four-day workshop offered by the SFS College, Nagpur. Here, we are here to share our experiences from our college. Our college is an A++ college, as told by our mentor, Dr. Alfred Cecil Raj. So here I am here to share our experiences in the first criterion, curriculum development. Shall I share my screens further?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please go ahead. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, sir. There is.
Father.
Yeah. Yeah. I think you've shared already, because what we can see is the Microsoft Teams. When you share on the left hand side, you have to share desktop or screen one. Try with screen one sharing.
Hello.
Yeah, yeah. Can you hear me? Hello. Hello. Do not know where the issue comes from. Yeah. Bhushan sir, you also coordinate. Let us try to help him in setting up. Dr. Jewell?
Hello.
Yeah, we can hear you. We can hear you.
Yeah. Shall I share?
It's coming. Yes, yes. It's visible. Okay. Good, good.
Okay, good. Thank
yeah.
you.
And you minimize all the other things, like you may find small box where I may feature. Kindly minimize okay. that. Go ahead, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Respected learned professors, good afternoon. In the preparation of criterion one, any institution should brainstorm the following ideas covering of the four key indicators, which are the expectations of NAC in its evaluation. Into seven aspects, following these four key indicators, they are, number one, the institution has an innovative mechanism for an effective curriculum delivery aligned with its vision and mission. This is the number one aspect. The second aspect is the curriculum encourages participative, collaborative, and lifelong learning for students, popularly known as student-centric learning approach. The third aspect is whether our pedagogy includes assignments, projects, class presentations, group discussions to equip the students on the 21st century job-oriented skills. Fifth aspect, whether the college undertakes various programs, environment consciousness, human values, and professional ethics. The sixth aspect is to make the learning more utilitarian, the institution offers choices of interdisciplinary subjects at various levels of the program. The last and most important aspect in this criterion is the IPAC of the institution encourages a three-element on this aspect. So every institution should brainstorm on these seven aspects and try to prepare this assessor. So this criterion one has 100 marks for you to evaluate, but the preparatory team of criterion one, criterion wise graded point average out of four. This question every people has to ask, how I have to maximize the criterion wise valuation on the overall CGP. These two questions, every criterion people has to ask on them. A small analysis made on the PG affiliated colleges. So far in NAC manual, there are 917 PG affiliated and above colleges where results are declared. In which, and since it's an A++ college, in criterion one, they got 4 out of 4. The remaining colleges of the 917, 23 colleges are get A+ grade, where only 3 colleges got 4 out of 4 in criterion 1. Well planning in the institution, with the support of all the members, not only the criterion people, one people, all the persons from top to bottom, how they much contribute. So I want to structure my talk based on metrics on these four key indicators available in criterion, like the key focus on the metric is to go for a better score. This is how I want to structureize my talk. So first key indicator one, curriculum, since we are an affiliated institution, we adopt curriculum provided by, and our curricular framework should follow an institutional goal with the institution goal. Not only the institutional goal will solve this problem, the resource potential will play a big role, and there should be a quality ambience culture should be prevailed throughout the curriculum process. And NAC keeps curriculum as the criterion, that's the base, all criteria. When you go for preparation of the SSR, as said by Dr. Cecil in the previous, first two metrics in criterion one are qualitative. When you want to prepare a criterion, you only have 500 words. Likewise, criterion one also, we have 500 words. So you can see here, there is a write-up area is given. This screenshot is taken from NAC portal, where you can type your response for this qualitative metric here. This is the write-up area. In addition to this write-up, you have to attach some supportive documents, which is given below, to make this claim valid. Whatever you have written to make this claim valid, you have to attach some supportive documents here. What are the key points when you take write-up? Most who go for A++, they try to write the points, they make the write-up only in point-like form, not in a paragraph form. How many certificate programs are given? What is my value addition in this curriculum fair? Try to highlight those important points. And you add some tables or images there. When you look at the final PDF form, it will not become as you expected. So how can I insert my images? Or if I have a flowchart of the curriculum, how can I add? You can create a PDF document, you can add it as a supportive document. So the fourth point is, say, convert everything as PDF file. Some file NAC expects only in Excel. Most of the file NAC expects in PDF file only. So try to convert every file into PDF file and add it as an additional document. So this is the way you have to write for the qualitative metrics. So the first metric in the key indicator 1.1, curriculum planning and implementation, wherever you see in the slide, in the top, there is a star mark. It indicates how much you have to score. So for this metric, NAC allocates 10 marks. So we have to strive to get this 10 weightage. So the first metric 1.1, then NAC asks for you whether the institution ensures effective curriculum delivery through a well-planned or documented process. So here you can focus like this. Your HOD may allocate the courses to the faculty members as per their expertise and options. The class and course-wise timetables are prepared for effective planning and delivery of the courses. The faculty prepares course outcome, a micro-level course plan, course notes, and course handouts, and the same can be circulated to the students on the day of the commencement. The teachers may import the curriculum through student-centric learning method, such as presentations, assignments, NPTEL lectures, and innovating teaching methods such as Google Classroom or Edmodo. Such learning management systems they can use. The HOD monitors the academic activities on a regular basis by verifying the syllabus coverage report to ensure the execution of effective teaching learning process as per the academic calendar. And if there is any gap, he can very well tell to the concerned department. The most crucial is the final point, where the IQAC of the institution tries to perform once or twice in a year an academic audit to ensure whether the curriculum is delivered in an effective manner. So the supportive documents per NAC is, you need to have some LMS. This is very crucial. If you have an LMS in your institution, you surely get the mark in an appropriate way, and they will expect some learning resources to be created by the institution. The academic induction programs and the lesson plan prepared by the faculty, then the syllabus coverage report. These are the documents where an institution can go for by creating as supportive documents. But how to score better? What among these documents, among this write-up, which should I focus on that? In my opinion, or in our opinion, we feel that these three things. One is usage of ICT tools in the pedagogical system of the college enables the students to learn the content not in a single way, in a multidimensional perspective. Second one, the college may have an opaque facility in the library in which an ILMS software where readers have access to this InfiliNet and other e-resources. The college has developed an ICT-based robust learning management system. You may develop your own, or you can use some open source systems like Google Classroom or Edmodo, in which the students and faculty can collaborate in a better way. To accomplish the curriculum delivery effectively, as I said earlier, annual academic audit is carried out and attainment of your course and program outcomes are ascertained. Since outcome-based education is primarily focused on earlier in only NBA colleges, now NAC wants even university and autonomous colleges to focus on this outcome-based education. But the design of the curriculum is along with the university, the affiliated colleges may try to strive for the outcomes from the students. The second metric on key indicator 1.1 is the academic calendar. NAC expects whether the institution adheres to the academic calendar, including the conduct of the continuous internal evaluation. Consider a college X adopts the curriculum designed by the university X. Normally, what the college will do, they will take the academic calendar of the university as a base for planning the curriculum delivery and the conduct of the CIE. The head of the institution conducts meetings with the head of the department for creating a detailed academic calendar. A well-structured academic calendar prepared by the HOD and approved by the institution head. The academic calendar should provide three things. Number one, the date of commencement of the academic session. Number two, submission of the midterm exam marks. Number three, the parent-teachers meeting or some other related activities conducted in the institution. The last point is the action plan for conducting any co-curricular activities to enrich them. So these are the key points you should focus on when you write the answer for this 1.12, that is the academic calendar adheres to with the university calendar. So here also NACS expects some supportive documents like the academic calendar provided by the university, the daily task sheet created by the departments, the prepared department academic calendar aligned with the university academic calendar, and any timetables or workloads that you can provide as supportive documents. Two key takeaways for this metric is, monitor, the head of the institution as well as HOD should monitor whether a structured academic calendar is prepared by the departments, and a proper monitoring and action plan should be there to get the full mark. So for this, that gives a weightage of 5. These two things, whatever we have seen so far, are in nature of qualitative metrics where we will do some write-up work. The remaining metric in this 1.1 key indicator is a quantitative metric. So I give you a brief introduction how to prepare for a quantitative metric. So NAC provides an Excel data template where you have to give your response for this quantitative metric. So qualitative metric, you have to make a write-up. For quantitative metrics, you have to enter the data into the Excel data template. So as we prepare some supportive documents for qualitative metrics, for quantitative metrics also, we have to create supportive documents to substantiate your claim on the data provided. So here I want to focus on four things when you go for preparing the quantitative metrics. Number one, as already mentioned by Dr. Cecil, in this Excel template, you can see in the left-hand side, in this Excel template, you are permitted to add some new rows, but you are not permitted to add any columns. And whenever in that, we give 5 years data,
where you try to segregate that 5 years as year one, year two, year three, year four, and year five. For example, if my accreditation period from 13 to 18, I can have my years are 13, 14, 14, 15, 15, 16, 16, 17, and 17, 18. And whenever you add a row in the Excel, keep in your mind there isn't supporting evidence. Without having a supportive evidence, don't create or don't add a row in this data template. So this is the thing you have to keep in mind when you want to prepare a quantitative metrics. So this is the only metric in Key Indicator 1.1 Curriculum Planning and Implementation where they ask for a quantitative metric answer from you. The NAC expects us whether the teachers participate in activities related to curriculum development assessment of the affiliated university. They want whether the teachers are participating in these four activities, academic council or board of studies, or setting question papers, or design of the curriculum, or assessment under the evaluation. To score better, very easily an institution score if all the four things you get evidences. What is something difficult for an institution is, if I am in the fifth year, but a faculty working in the first year who is not available at the present, he may be a member of the board of studies, the document may not be available with the institution. This is very difficult for the institution now to get the document from a faculty who gone out of the institution. But hereby, the institution should try to collect as much documents as possible, either from the outgoing faculty or the faculty who are present in the institution, and to try to prove documents on these four aspects. So, in addition to that, sometimes the data verification and validation team ask documents for randomly selected teachers. Why I'm insisting here, in your Excel template, you may add a row saying that your faculty name, Gulcharan Singh, he may participate in board of studies. But if you don't have a supportive document for that row and you try to upload the data in the NAC, by chance, the DA team, by chance only, they select a row and they see the supportive document. If the document is not available, they come for us. That will be a problem for us at the time of verification. So try to see that every data is associated with every row in the data template. And try to get appointment letters for valuation or practical exams or YYOC can be considered here. But you cannot claim a participation other than affiliate university. So you may be in University of X. You cannot claim, I have gone for a valuation in University Y and you can make a claim here. But a college that is affiliated to this university, that you may go. But you cannot go for a university that is affiliated in a different district or different state. So this is how the debates try to fill in the reverse chronological order. So if 2017-18 is my latest year, you fill that first and the name of the teacher participated and the name of the body in which the full-time teacher participated. This is how you have to fill the data template. So whenever you have the row, try to create a supportive document for that. So these are some of the supportive documents you can get. These documents you can see in the NAC manual and you can try to collect this document. If you get all the four, if you collect documents for all the evidences available in the all the four categories expected by NAC. With this, we are going to key indicator 1.2, that is academic flexibility. What NAC expects in academic flexibility is the glimpses are whether the institution has any freedom in the use of time framing of the courses. Every institution will focus on the vertical mobility, whether an institution has horizontal mobility, and there are interdisciplinary options are provided in the curriculum. That's what NAC expects in this key indicator. In addition to that, whether enrichment programs for job-oriented skills are provided by the institution, supplementary enrichment programs and credit system and the choice, different type of choices like choice-based credit system or elective system, how they are implemented in various programs of the institutions should be the main focus of this key indicator 1.2. In this one, we have again three metrics. The first metric NAC expect is the percentage of programs in which choice-based credit system or elective system is implemented. the key areas are, try to see that if you have 15 programs, what are the programs are comes under choice-based credit system? There may be 8 or 10 programs. Or of the remaining programs, whether they are in the purview of elective system. Think that. So think whether your programs are either in choice-based credit system or elective, or sometimes both can be there. There are possibilities there. If a program falls under elective system as based credit system, that details alone is sufficient. For that, NAC expects data from here, the template. You have a program code. Normally, many institutions will tell us how to formulate this program code. University never gives a program code for us. Somebody tried to formulate a four-letter programming code. You can see here, BSc Home Science, first row you can see the program, a unique program code. But keep in mind that this is the first place where you are creating the program code for affiliated college. The same program code should be used in wherever template in across the criteria. You cannot create one program code here and different program code in different places. That will create a confusion in the data verification field. So try to create a program code, program name you have, and the year of introduction of the program. When this program introduced in your college? And the next data they are asking is whether this program has an implementation of CBCS or IQ. You have to write yes or no. You have to type yes or no. And if you say yes, you have to mention the year of implementation. Don't forget to give a link. Many of the institutions I have seen, they will not provide this link. A link is very, very crucial. When the NAC people try to click this link, this should not point to your institution homepage website. It should point to the exact link. So try to fill the data templates. Don't leave any cell empty. So this is the first metric, CBCS or elective courses offered in your programs. The second, similarly, like every program, you have some supportive documents. I don't want to read these supportive documents. You can see it from the standard operating procedure. As Dr. Cecil said, there are some MCQ questions. There are some formula-based questions. This 1.2.1 is a formula-based question. Why I am introducing this slide here is, you must understand the importance of formula. In addition to the importance of formula, that is an important input you have to give. That input is called extended profile input. Whenever you give some response to a metric, that response will come as the numerator. You can see here the formula for 1.2.1. There is a numerator response is that number of programs in which choice-based or elective course. This is your response, institution's response. This will come as in the numerator, where you can see the denominator where this data you are not going to give. You will not give this data in the portal. But we give this data in another form that we call it as extended profile. So the denominator part data will be taken from the extended profile. The extended profile also will look similar to an Excel template only, but it is a separate document, not your metric-wise response document. So you can see here that for criterion one, there is an extended profile document. They ask for program code, program name, and what are all the courses you are offering and the year of introduction. This external profile is going to act as denominator for two criterions. One is 1.2.1, the currently what we are seeing, CBCS or elective system. Another criterion we will see in 1.3 key indicator in the metric 1.3.2, experiential learning. Many times we talk about what is my score, what is my score, how I have to score, how my weightage is converted to score. This is the point every institution will have. For them, I tell how the weightage is going to convert to a score. Whenever you give a response, NAC try to convert it to a scale of 0 to 4. And they will have a weightage for each metric. Here you can see I have given a weightage as 20. Suppose for your response, a question, I have given as triplex, I have not given any response. If you give some response, that response is converted into this scale. This scale is multiplied with the weightage and your final score will be calculated here. This is how your score will be calculated For example, you can take a sample here. A question may be asked for you. How much percentage of faculty or PhD among your total faculty? This is a metric, not related to criteria one. I have taken as a sample. For this metric, NAAC assigns a weightage as 20. Suppose an institution gives sample response as 200. That is the total number of faculty. This will be the denominator. The numerator will be the faculty with PhD. That is your response for the institution where you get 120. Now when you calculate the formula, you get an average of 60%. Now for 60%, whether out of the scale of 4, whether I can get 4 or 3 or 2, this we cannot know. This benchmark, no institution knows, only NAAC will know. NAAC will set when they evaluate your metric. For example, I have put a sample that if your response 60% falls under this response of 3 scale, your institution will get a scale of 3. So the weightage is 20. So multiplying with the weightage, the score of the metric you get is 60. This is how every metric will be calculated with the score by multiplying with the weightage. So in the second metric of the key indicator 1.1, NAAC wants to know whether the institution is offering any add-on or certificate programs. So every institution tries to collect this add-on or certificate programs, but NAAC insists that these add-on or certificate programs should be of minimum 30 hours. This should you keep in mind. Every add-on or certificate program should have a minimum of 30 hours, and you should avoid programs conducted under the university curriculum. So the program you are connecting, for example, say that cyber ethics, a program you are offering as a add-on program, that cyber ethics should not come under the curriculum of the university. That you have to keep in mind. But when you try to give this response for this metric, you give the response for 5 years. You may introduce a certificate program cyber ethics on the first year. The same program may be continued on the second year, third year, and fourth year. But when NAAC expects the number of programs, you have to calculate the number of unique programs only and try to give a response. You cannot say that I am giving cyber ethics on every year and I have a count of 5, so I give my response as 5. It's not correct. So your response should be unique programs across 5 years. Moreover, the 1.22 metric add-on or certificate program is combined with another metric 1.2.3, where NAAC expects how many students are enrolled in this add-on or certificate programs. So before going to 1.2.3, you can see that the data template for this add-on or certificate programs, the same template is applicable for 1.2.3 also. There is no difference between the templates 1.2.2 and 1.2.3, where they ask the year-wise, the number of value, the first column, number of value-added courses, the course code, you can formulate a course code, then you are offering this certificate program, number of times offered in the year. Suppose the program may be discontinued, they may be offered in the first year. After the third year, the program may be discontinued. You provide the discontinuation year. Here itself, they ask for the data for the 1.2.3. You can see here the last two columns, number of students enrolled in a particular year and the number of students completing the program in the particular year. So these two columns will be applicable for 1.2.3. That's why I said the same data template is applicable for 1.2.2 and 1.2.3. So supportive documents, you have to create a summary report for every program. A well-defined write-up of all the program summary report is needed. Syllabus for each of the certificate programs you are offering and how you are going to assess. Because you are offering the certificate programs or add-on programs, what is your assessment procedures? How we are evaluating the student? The assessment procedure you can give. These all will add your weightage on the mark, and NAAC feels that they are contributing something to the metric and try to boost your mark on this. So key takeaways are two things I feel. How an institution plan in offering courses with multidisciplinary approach. For example, how a science students can take a certificate programs in an art stream, or in the opposite way, how an art student is taking a certificate program or add-on program in it. So a multidisciplinary approach is needed here. and more crucially, try to offer some courses through online, because digitalization is the mantra in India. So you may also think in some aspect where some of the courses or study courses you can offer through online. So these two key takeaways you have to keep in mind. The third metric in 1.2 is 1.23 students enrolled. Here, the DEV will try to ask some certificates. You are offering a certificate program. You may give some certificates to the students. Randomly, DEV will what do? They will ask some certificates for a selected students in a particular course. Not only certificate, you have to keep in mind there are some documents additional to this certificates is needed. The attendance sheet is very, very compulsory. Not only certificates will prove you are conducting the course. Attendance is needed. A full-fledged students list course-wise is needed here. So 1.22 and 1.23 are combined. Try to collect as much document as possible across the years to get a better score. So here you can see from the metric. So the denominator, the numerator you can take from the data template. The denominator you can take it from the extended profile. This slide shows that. So in a NAC portal, you can see when you try to enter the quantitative metric, there will be three parts where the institution will give response in the middle area. There is a top portion, there is a bottom portion. In the middle portion only, institution will try to give the response in the 5 years, where you can, they give editable options. In the below, you can see there is a related input. This input, we will not be able to give. This is what I said, the data will be automatically taken from the extended profile data. And the formula is applied, and automatically once you fetch, once you provide this data and the extended profile data is fetched, you can see the top data, the QAF value. It cannot be editable by you. It is calculated by the software, and the response will be given in the top portion. Now we go to the third key indicator, that is called curriculum enrichment, where the NAC expects on these three areas whether the institution provides any value-added courses and activities not directly linked with a single discipline, and whether the institution sensitizes the students to cross-cutting issues, at least in national level, on these four areas. One is gender, number two is environment and sustainability, number three, human values, number four, professional engagement. In addition to this, the NAC expects the development of creative and divergent competencies among students in inculcation of these courses. So the 1.3.1, NAC expects us whether the institution integrate cross-cutting. You can think of writing something like this is a qualitative metric. You can think of writing like this: your academic flexibility is envisaged at the institution and department levels. At the institution level, whether you are offering courses like EVS, humanity courses, fundamentals of human rights. In our college, we have a separate department for this program, for this thing. We call it as Department of Human Excellence. Formally, it is called as for UG students. This material is prepared by our own staff members to deliver the course. And you can think of some other courses like cybercrime, which can be offered for your first UG students as computer literacy in this metric. And you can think of a soft skills, number of courses where you can embed this cross-cutting. In our institution, when we look into the curriculum, we found that around 160 cross-cutting issues are embedded in various courses in the sense of social justice, responsibility, and compassion. So you also work in those area. For those, again, you can keep supportive documents, the affiliating university letter you can keep for this program, some EVS and university can give to connect such programs, syllabus for such programs, and the photograph of activities. So the four key takeaways you can take here is, you can address some environmental issues, you can have some gender sensitivity activities, you can incorporate the professional ethics into the curriculum, and you can sensitize students into the human values. For example, in environmental activities, you may have clubs like Energy Conservation Club or Eco Club, where you can involve every stakeholder through seminar by villages in making the sensitization towards health, hygiene, and cleanliness issues. Likewise, gender sensitivity activities like organizing workshops regarding legal rights on every gender. In one of the top-ranked colleges we come across, they motivated to install an app called Durga Shakti app, an initiative of the Haryana police, which promotes safety and security of the women. Likewise, you can see that any activities you have in your institution in incorporating the professional ethics or how you are sensitizing the students to human values. The next metric is experiential learning, where NAC expects how many of your courses. You may have around 200, 300 courses. In those courses, how many of them fall under give for 5 years. So try to focus on courses only that have project work, field work, or internship as per your affiliated university curriculum. The data template is given here. You can see which program you are offering that experience, project work, field work is come here. The course code in which year is offering and the number of students studying and the link of the relevant document. Count the student as one if he involves in multiple projects, field work, or internship. For example, a BSc company into the template, you have to count the student as one and try to give your response. So DNA will ask for some internship or project completion certificate for selected students. So try to collect all the internship and project completion certificates across the years. If you try to provide via list of students, it will not going to solve any issues. To get a better score, you have to collect all the certificates and write a report from the students and keep it as an additional document. The last key indicator, 1.4 feedback system, where NAC expects from this system, and we also see that most of the institution will get this 20. You can see the right-hand corner, the 20 weightage. Every institution will get this 20 for their thing. And NAC expects, and NAC aspects only 4 things, whether you are collecting feedback from these 4 stakeholders. They are students, teachers, alumni, and employees. And you may ask the questionnaire in various angles, various dimensions, but NAC wants you to collect feedback only on the curricula. That you have to keep in mind. So your question, some part of the question on the feedback should focus on the curriculum. So those questions also should have some relevance needs to societal concern, economy, and environmental concern. Not only collecting a feedback from the stakeholders is essential. In addition to collection of the data, you have to analyze the data, identify the pertinent pointers to enhance your learning activity. So it is a very easy way. You can surely get full mark here. Okay, for this metric, you can, for this key indicator, there is only 2 metrics. For the 2 metrics, you can surely get full out of full marks. So try to collect data from these 4 people, students, teachers, alumni, and parents. As I said earlier, feedback should be concerned only with the curriculum. And create a questionnaire. You can see here, I have shown you a sample questionnaire. If you upload a questionnaire for this 1.41 like this, NAC will surely reject what they expect. This question is for student. This is not expected. What they expect is a filled-in question. You can see a student has filled in some question. Minimum 3 filled-in forms for the 4 stakeholders you have to keep. Not an empty questionnaire as I showed earlier. You have to keep a filled-in questionnaire and 3 in numbers you have to keep, not only for one stakeholder, for all the stakeholders you have to keep 3 filled-in forms. Like students, how we collected, we have to collect for teachers, a feedback questionnaire, alumni, and employee. Since teachers and students, it is easy for us to collect a questionnaire, giving questionnaire and collecting it, but what NAC expects, how an institution gets a feedback from the alumni, whether they are collecting feedback correctly, same way, try to get the feedbacks from your employers. Your employees may come for recruitment drive. Try to collect feedbacks from those organizations also and try to give their responses here also. So the 1.42, once you collected the feedback, you have to make an analysis. So NAT expects four ways you do this analysis. Your institution should not go for the below three. Your institution should go only for the first option. The first option states that feedback is collected, good. Whether the feedback is analyzed, yeah, we are analyzing. Whether we are taking action on the feedback collected analysis, yes. And among all these three, very important is this feedback and action taken by the department institution should be available in your institution website. This is very, very important. Not only collecting, not only analyzing, analyzing the results among the institution is not going to fetch a full mark. This analysis and action taken, this feedback should be available in your website. So try to go for the first option. So feedback report should be posted on the institution website. That link should be directly landing on the chosen option. Whichever report you give, you have to choose that. The link should go there. And in the SOP, they said this feedback should be communicated with the affiliation university because they are designing the curriculum. They expect how the affiliated institutes collecting this feedback, and they want to share these responses to the university. It is well and good if you communicate this feedback to the university, and the university will take some action when they design curriculum on the feedback that they will take, and they will do for this curriculum design. We have supportive documents like the stakeholder feedback report, create some charts when you do analysis, and most important is the action taken report. For the feedback, what the institution or department takes some action, how it is incorporated, how it is passed in the board, either in the governing council, governing body, or academic council, that is very crucial. This is bonus. I am going to end my talk. Dr. Sessas slightly touched this criterion, slightly touched this on this topic. When you document for any credit, that is either quantitative or qualitative, try to create a folder structure. You may know there are seven criterions. So we suggest that to create seven folders, and in each folder, you try to have three subfolders. One is for DVD, that is the extended profile, and the documents you are going for uploading, and what are the documents you are going to upload in your website. The second upload is going to upload for your NAT. So these three subfolders you create for every criterion. So in the first year DVV, you can keep all your templates in a proper chronological order. Whatever you're going to give links, you keep in the upload folder. And whatever you are going to upload in your college website, you keep it in the website folder. And try to have a naming mechanism for every files. You can see the example. So for your 3.2.1 metric, I have given a naming like this. KM is key indicator metric. So you have a college, SFS. You can give the name as SFS. SFS underscore 3.2.1. Since it's a quantitative metric, you can give QNM. And since it's a year-wise data, you can give 2013, 14, or 16, 17, or 19, 20, that year, and a small description about the document. If you name a data or document like this, it will be easy for you to search in the later part for the IQAC or in the department, and try to take as much backup as possible, not losing the data. Since data is an oil nowadays, so losing a data is a huge loss for the institution. So try to take backup periodically in the institution, not only on criterion one, on all the seven criterions, the IQAC should have a proper feedback mechanism, sorry, proper backup mechanism to maintain their data.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Is there any question?
Live question answer session. Computer science, because the slideshow that you had was very clear, very systematic, and you can give us some tips also how to make beautiful slide was self-explanatory, as you were supposed to explain the first criterion on curricular aspects. Now, you have definitely given us inputs on how to maximize the criterion-wise weighted grade point average.
Yes,
and when you said that we should go ahead like getting 4 out of 4. That was very optimistic. We were filled with hope, and that colleges that you are looking after is really marvelous. And you also told us how to write descriptive answers. like fine. Just make it out to make it bullet wise, point wise, highlight them. That is also a very good eye opener for us. And you have also told us how to prepare for quantitative metrics by way of entering data in the Excel sheets. So both qualitative as well as quantitative metrics, how they have to be filled and uploaded. Then you have told us how to create supportive evidence, which is very important. And as you said, if the data is lost, I think your work is lost, your hard work is lost. And I think the data is very precious to us when we prepare the SSR. Very informative, and people have really given their thumbs up. So, sir, I am really indebted to you from the bottom of my heart. And I would express that our collaboration would continue. Our collaboration would continue, that you will enlighten us more in the days. Like you spoke about those add-on courses or certificate program courses, etc. So how to motivate the students for such kind of courses, especially when you have a tight schedule? Like your timetable is packed from morning 7:30, let's say, or 8 or 8:30 till evening 5:30. And then in between you said that timetable. So how can we, in a way, motivate students, and how can we incorporate such kind of add-on courses? And I also would like to ask you, like, which are some of the add-on courses that you would think that is the need of the hour, or you would think that when everything resumes normal, or even in the online online scenario, which are the courses that we can go for?
Thank you, Father. To answer how we are going to offer certificate programs and how to motivate the students, if you see that the metric key takeaways, I have mentioned the second key takeaway is, if your course is fully packed, try to incorporate such courses not in a regular stream. You can try to give your courses in an asynchronous way. Try to offer your courses in an online mode, where the student can take synchronous way in an asynchronous way. That's the way you can offer a separate program when your schedule is fully packed. Try to think that nowadays we have many platforms like Google Classrooms, Edmodo, where you can offer some courses in offline mode. Give some assignments, give some questionnaires, upload your videos there, prepared videos. You have to complete the certificate programs in your schedule, stick on some schedule, but go on an asynchronous mode and try to complete this certificate course if your schedule is packed. And the second part is, you said some interesting courses. I am not a multidisciplinary approach. If you ask computer science, I said you can go for a data science course, which is a wanted of the hour, or a course on artificial intelligence, your course implement them.
I think a little bit of machine learning, Python and all that.
Python, yes, Father, you can go. Surely those things, students surely go and work on the 21st century job-oriented skills.
That's very good. Thank you very much, sir, for that input. That was just full marks, 20. And that's very good sign of relief. Nevertheless, we have to work hard for that. But then, according to you, from the other three key indicators, 0.1, 1.2, and 1.3, which you would think that needs more work, or which reward that you desire? Maybe the problem or the fault is not with us, but then sometimes the fault is with the questions that are framed, perhaps. Yeah. So what has been your experience?
This is the way how much your institution collects the data or the documents. We cannot go on creating HR missing or data, and you try to put it in a proper way. More than that, quantitative, we cannot do anything. But try to collect the missing data. That is our answer, some qualitative metrics, not only on criterion one, for any criterion, have a brainstorming sessions. In our experiences, we have more than 100 meetings with the principal. Similarly, he will meet principal, he will tell what it is going, how work is going, how he has collected the documents, what is missing, how we have to write, how the writer should be pruned. Likewise, you have to evaluate on the qualitative metric, will try to see the highlighted points and try to give you more mark. So since criteria one is a base, you have to put a lot and lot of effort. 1.4 also I said easy, but it's not an easy, but with the little effort you can go for higher weightage. But all other key indicators, you have to put a very strong effort, but you can surely have a good one.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Pertaining to maybe curricular aspects, in a sense, NAC has given us, but somebody, now because we are in this pandemic, And people are saying, you have to introduce open book system like at more regular frequency. So such kind of questions have been asked. I clubbed a few of the questions together. Like, you think that completely getting away with, of course, an evaluation system is not good. What kind of evaluation system should we have? Question that the participants have asked.
The mugging up system will only give you a rote learning among the people. That is not the correct approach. From IIT, a person from IIT Kanpur, where they said even IIT institutions are not very clear how to go for an evaluation in an online pandemic situation. St. Joseph's also is trying, even in BOOC software development, we have to give a certificate on skill courses. So we are also working how to evaluate the students, how to evaluate the student skill. If it is a theory portion, we can try to have some person calculation on the internal and go for an external evaluation. But in a skill paper, the evaluation is a very, very tough question to go for an evaluation. Maybe a framework is needed from UGC and the higher education institutions on these things. I'm not very good in answering this, I think.
Yeah. No, no, no. So, sir, you're in teaching, learning,
yes, sir, sure.
I think we will have more brainstorming there. So once again, I thank you very much, Dr. Jude Nirmal, for sparing your time for us and implementing all that you have talked to us. And I, for one, surely will go through this video presentation again and again, because I'm supposed to head this criterion of our college with the help of some others. And it had everything. It had everything. And I'm sure, and many people have been asking us, like, give the PPT, give the PPT. To those, I would like to say, our videos are available on the YouTube channel of the college. So kindly subscribe to our college channel and you will find all the videos, not only for this criterion, the keynote address and the days to follow. So it was very, indeed, our great privilege. Yeah, you can leave the meeting or you can be there. You can switch off your video. A few announcements before I wind up today's session. I know that for criterion 2 and criterion 3. In criterion 2, teaching, learning and evaluation, we have eminent personality at St. Joseph's College, Tiruchirappalli. And for the third criterion, we have, which is research, consultancy, and experiment, associate professor, rehabilitation science, Holy Cross College, Tiruchirappalli. So it's going to be, again, very enlightening session, querying, requesting for the feedback forms. Kindly, you will find them in all the platforms, be it Microsoft Teams, or that is mandatory to receive your e-certificate. That's all I have to say for now, for today, and I wish you all a that is mandatory to receive your e-certificate. That's all I have to say.